Good afternoon. Today is the 10th day of January 2016, and I'm very happy to have Babu with us again. Welcome, Babu.
Thank you.
Today we decided to talk about poetry. And there's so much to cover, it may take us more than a half an hour. What periods of poetry interested you most?
I really go after my guru because he also has a marked preference for romantic poetry. There is no denial, no doubting about it. And I also have been sort of nurtured on romantic poetry. In the beginning, when I was much younger, I didn't appreciate Shakespeare so much. But then gradually, as I studied him more and then started teaching, I started appreciating Shakespeare also. And then we find that the Romantics had re-established the link with the Elizabethan age.
Yes.
And exactly what Sandhu says in the future poetry, that the period that succeeded the Elizabethan age, they wanted to develop the intellect. And for that, Milton made a kind of synthesis between the Elizabethan age as well as developing the intellect. But after him came Dryden and Pope, and they went all out for rational poetry. And I feel, they wanted to sort of purify the atmosphere of too much of romanticism and emotion and all those things. But I feel that what they did was throw the baby with the bathwater. And they really, all the beautiful, most beautiful things of the Elizabethan age, they just discarded. Now that the Romantics brought back, and they went one step further, and then they touched what Sandhu would call poetry of the spirit or psychic poetry. So that's why the Romantics immediately, touched me. But then I also, as I told you earlier, that I also appreciate some of the Victorian poets like Meredith, then Robert Browning. Browning actually I find very entertaining and very, very interesting, because on one side he has got the very rational mind, on the other side he has got the emotional turn, and finally, and which actually appeals to me, he has got a very good sense of humor.
Mm.
And in some of the poems, we find that humor. So that's why I appreciate Browning. And, he is absolutely a he-man. He believes in God, he believes in love, and everything is all right in the world. So, Browning I like very much.
Do you have a favorite poem of his you could read?
Browning's, well, I could do that.
I don't think Sri Aurobindo had the highest opinion of him.
But he appreciates
Browning. But he appreciated some of his work, yes.
He appreciates quite a bit of his, what is known as his knowledge of human psychology. He has actually said that in one dramatic monologue of Robert Browning,
mm-hmm.
you find more of psychology than in all the plays of Shakespeare put together. He has made that statement.
I see.
I'm quite categorical.
In the future poetry?
In the future poetry.
Yeah.
So he has made that statement. And we find that Shakespeare, he merely touches on the human psychology,
mm-hmm.
and he doesn't go deep into it. Whereas Browning goes into a kind of analysis, and that is because I've been a student of psychology also, so I appreciate that part, that how he is going deep into it. And then some of his sayings are, some of his lines are so quotable and also so inspiring. For example, in his poem Rabbi Ben Ezra, he makes a fantastic statement. He says, "Not on the vulgar mass called work must sentence pass, things done that took the eye and had the price, over which from level stand the low world laid its hand, found straightway to its mark, could value in a trice." Is a tremendous statement to make, that you shouldn't judge a person by what he has been able to achieve. And he says something which appeals to me very much, that God does not judge a person by where he has been successful, but by what he has tried to do. So this is a tremendous and very courageous thing to say. Of course, means one can argue against it, saying that then how are you going to judge whether somebody is great or not? So he says that is secondary, because what is important is that we are made by God, and whether God thinks us of any value, that is more important than the human estimation.
Yes.
Okay? So that he gives us that image of the potter. He says, time's wheel runs back or stops, potter and clay endure. So he gives a beautiful image of the potter and clay. I don't know if you...
That they endure. I know Haren's wonderful poem, Shaper Shaped.
Quite right. But here what Browning says, that man and his soul and God, especially soul and God, they are eternal. They'll always be there, and they're the most valuable thing. And the potter's wheel is the time and the earth. So God has put us on the earth to be shaped. And you know, that idea comes quite close to Sivindu's idea,
yes,
about the evolution.
Yes.
That is, the soul has to take births, you know, to get more and more experience and also get purified.
Yes.
So in that way we advance.
And the wheel and the clay endure.
The clay and the potter endure.
The clay and the potter endure, right.
The wheel doesn't matter.
Right.
Because the wheel is only an instrument. Potter and clay endure.
Very beautiful.
It's a beautiful idea.
Would you read us a poem of Browning?
Let's see. No, I'm sorry. I've forgotten. But I can recite some of the lines to you.
Okay.
He says, "He fixed thee mid this dance of plastic circumstance, this present which thou forsooth would soon arrest, machinery just meant to give thy soul its bent. Turn thee and try thee forth sufficiently impressed." So it is, he is giving you the image of the potter, and he is talking about the world, and the world is a kind of a dance of plastic circumstance. Things are constantly moving.
Right.
So we always feel that we have to keep up with the time, because otherwise we'll sort of fall off the wheel. But it is not that. We have to have the faith in God that we have to try and understand why time moves fast, why passive lies are clay. So he gives you a beautiful idea that suppose you take the lump of clay and place it on the wheel. Now the clay has a mind of its own and it wants to do something. Okay? It doesn't want to obey the potter. What will happen? The pot will never be made. So the clay has to be passive. But it's a kind of conscious passivity, a kind of surrender to God.
That it allows itself to be shaped.
That's it.
Yes.
That's it.
Yes.
So all these beautiful ideas Browning gives us.
Mm.
And he talks about why one should not judge a person by what he has been able to achieve. Because God doesn't judge according to that. So Browning says, thoughts hardly to be packed into a narrow act, fancies that broke through language and escaped, all I could never be, all men ignored in me, this I was worth to God, whose wheel the pitcher shaped. Okay, and it's a wonderful thing really. See, means you can take a person who really has an aspiration, who wants to change the world, but he knows that he doesn't have the capacity to do it. And maybe even when he tries, he fails. So people judge him by his failure, that he couldn't do it. But the thing is that God judges by what he wanted to do.
The aspiration behind.
The aspiration behind.
Yes.
Now that, tells us lots of things and also, gives us hope, especially the so-called failures. That they because they have just tried, that's more than enough.
See? I read a very strong criticism of Edith Sitwell today.
Uh-huh.
In which the critic says that she failed in everything, but I enjoy her because I enjoy reading her failures, because one can learn a lot from it.
Wonderful, absolutely, very, very true, very true.
Other than Browning, where do we move next in your favorites list?
My favorite, of course, Francis Thompson.
Ah.
He's a wonderful one. Hound of Heaven, of course. But he's got some little poems which are really beautiful.
Mm.
Just one moment. I'll read to you the Kingdom of God.
Mm.
O world invisible, we view thee. O world intangible, we touch thee. O world unknowable, we know thee. Inapprehensible, we clutch thee. Does the fish soar to find the ocean? The eagle plunge to find the air? That we ask of the stars in motion, if they have rumor of thee there? Not where the wheeling systems darken, and our benumbed conceiving souls, the drift of pinions, would we hearken, beats at our own clay-shuttered doors. The angels keep their ancient places, turn but stone and start a wing, 'Tis ye, 'tis your estranged faces that miss the many splendid thing. But when so sad, thou canst not sadder cry, and upon thy so sore loss shall shine the traffic of Jacob's ladder pitched between heaven and Charing Cross. Yea, in the night, my soul, my daughter, cry, clinging heaven by the hems, and lo, Christ walking on the water, not of Genesareth, but Thames. Yes, God is everywhere.
Yeah.
All you have to do is to have the cry. Naturally, it is a aspiration,
the call.
And then you will
yes.
see him
yes.
before you.
Beautiful.
These are all yes. very beautiful ideas.
Yeah. Yeah, I didn't know that poem at all.
Oh, you didn't know it?
No.
It's one of my favorites. And he gives you a beautiful picture, you know, as though the beginning of creation. He says, not where the wheeling system darken and our benumbed conceiving source. You try to imagine space. Usually, we merely say that, well, in space there is, I mean, all the constellations and everything is there, the stars and
galaxies.
The planets and the galaxies and all that. And we just say it. We don't try to understand. But if you try to conceive of it, you'll go mad. You'll lose your head. And that's why we merely say even the simple thing. We say that, well, they have discovered a new star. It is so many thousand light years away. Have you ever tried to calculate this so many thousand light years?
No.
So what would happen then?
Yeah.
Now he says that God is not in that kind of abstract situation, far, far away from us,
yeah.
but he is within us. So he says, not where the wheeling system darkened and our benumbed conceiving source, we try to find God there, and actually we lose him. The drift of pinions, wings
yeah.
would we hearken? All we have to do is to listen to our heart and beat out at our own clay-shuttered doors. So,
and the beginning I liked very much too.
Oh, world invisible,
yes.
we view thee.
Yes.
Oh, world intangible, we touch thee.
Yeah.
Oh, world unknowable, we know thee. Inapprehensible, we clutch thee.
Yeah.
That is, all this, oh, world and all, it all stands for God. That we say that God is beyond our comprehension, beyond our conception, but it's nothing of the sort. He is very much with us. And that comes from personal faith and personal experience.
Yes, yes. So we have Browning, we have Thompson. And then?
Okay, I'll give you another one of Thompson.
Oh, wonderful.
There's also very delicate, very, very delicate. It is to a snowflake. Have you come across it?
I don't believe so.
To a snowflake. What heart could have taught you, past your devisal, O filigree petal, fashioned so purely, fragilely, surely, from what paradisal, imagineless metal, too costly for cost? Who hammered you, wrought you, from Argentine vapor? God was my shaper. Passing surmisal, he hammered, he wrought me, from curled silver vapor to lust of his mind. Thou couldst not have taught me so purely, so palely, tinily, surely, mightily, frailly, insculped and embossed with his hammer of wind and his graver of frost. See that?
All from that snowflake.
All from that snowflake.
How beautiful.
And the snowflake says how God created the snowflake.
Yeah. Yeah.
Then I appreciate Blake also quite a lot. Of course, we are going back in time, but I appreciate Blake quite a lot. Not everything that he has written, but especially his poem, The Tiger.
Auguries of Innocence. Auguries of Innocence I like.
That's it, Auguries of Innocence also. Yes. But Tiger comes in Auguries of Experience.
Yes.
Auguries of Experience. Yeah. And Sarinda has spoken very, very highly about Blake. He says that Blake, for a long time, he was not discovered. And people thought that he was a very ordinary and kind of childish poet. But then some of the things that he says, they are unbelievable. Yeah. And my favorite lines are, it comes from Auguries of Innocence. It comes from Auguries of Experience. So he says, O world invisible, I quoted Francis Thompson.
Right.
He says, to see the world in a grain of sand and heaven in a wild flower, hold infinity in the palm of your hand and eternity in an hour.
I mean,
what a thing to say, really.
Really.
But
one of the greatest four lines, really.
Definitely. And if you read Amal's Tiger,
his explanation of Blake's Tiger.
That is really a tremendous thing.
Would you read The Tiger?
I like it.
Sure.
You don't have to read it, I know. Tiger, tiger, burning bright in the forests of the night, what immortal hand or eye could frame thy fearful symmetry? In what distant deeps or skies burn the fire of thine eyes? In what wings dare he aspire? What the hand dare seize the fire? And what shoulder and what heart could twist the sinews of thy heart? And when thy heart began to beat, what dread hand and what dread feet? What the hammer, what the chain, in what...
What the hammer, what the chain.
Oh God, what's happened to me? This is old age catching up.
Not very quickly. You're 82 now, right? You're 82. It's not catching up very fast.
What the hammer, what the chain, in what furnace was thy brain? What the anvil, what dread grasp, dare its deadly terrors clasp? What is happening to me? I think it must be nervousness.
I think so.
Because usually I can just go on. But that's why I think I'm overconfidence or something. Right. And these are my favorite lines and I forgot. When the stars threw down their spears and watered heaven with their tears, did he smile his work to see? Did he who made the lamb make thee?
Yes. Wow.
And there, you know, these stars throwing down their spears, it is, this lady who is an expert on tiger, and Amul was inspired by her writing, and then he corresponded with her.
Was she a poet?
She is a critic. Maybe something of a poet also. I'm not getting.
I remember his correspondence with Kathleen Rain.
Kathleen Rain, you're right. Kathleen Rain. So Kathleen Rain.
Yes.
And there she gives some other interpretation of when the stars threw down their spears. And Amal gives the interpretation which I am not very happy with. He talks about the the revolt of the angels and their despair when they found that God was all-powerful, that God had the secret weapon and he defeated them. So that's why the stars were in despair.
I saw it totally differently.
I also think totally differently.
When they throw down, they're throwing the light onto us.
I look at it in a slightly different manner.
Good.
And I say that when the stars threw down their spears and watered heaven with their tears, okay? Now the stars are supposed to be the sentinels. The sentinels, and they're the keepers.
So they discarded their spears.
That's it. And they're supposed to be the keepers of law and order. It is they who keep order in the whole universe so that everything runs smoothly. So they're the sentinels. Now, when God created the tiger is so ferocious, at the same time very beautiful, and he seems to be beyond anybody's control. He can do whatever he likes.
He's a force.
The tiger itself.
Yes, yes.
Okay. And now, the stars, they think that, or rather, they're in despair, that they will not be able to control the tiger.
So the tears.
And so, in sheer despair, they threw down their spears. Okay, he says, threw down their spears,
yes,
as though they are surrendering.
Ah, yes.
And watered heaven with their tears, naturally in desperation.
Right.
Now, God is smiling. Why? God is smiling because God knows that he has created the tiger in order to fight evil. That means the tiger is on the side of the stars.
Very beautiful.
I look at it in that way.
That
and sometimes we have, especially in Indian mythology, that sometimes to destroy evil, you have to become more ferocious, more dangerous than evil itself. We find, you know, constantly in the mythological stories that to destroy the asuras, the goddess took some frightening forms. She who is all beauty became most ferocious and most frightening. So I look at it in that way, that God created the tiger not as something evil. Because you see, usually they compare, did he who made the lamb make thee?
Yeah, and so that comparison means why?
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 So as though Blake is, he himself can't understand.
Yeah.
But the very fact, he says, did he smile his work to see? That means God has some secret knowledge which he hasn't shared with the stars. I find it in,
yeah.
I interpret it in that way.
Very beautiful. Really
so,
very beautiful. And Blake also had that childlike innocence.
That childlike thing. That's why you have his famous one. Little lamb, who made thee?
Yes.
Dost thou know who made thee?
Yes.
So that kind of thing. Very, very childlike, very innocent.
But carrying its own beauty.
Definitely.
Yes.
Definitely.
Yes. Yes.
No, that's why, you know, his contemporaries, he was born at a wrong time, really. Very, very wrong time. Because he lived at the time when the Industrial Revolution was just coming into its own. And people were all for science and scientific inventions which would change man's life.
Yeah.
But Blake had that thing where he calls these factories, just imagine, around, he was born in 1857, so let's say around, 1757, sorry. So let's say around the beginning of the 18th century. So at that time he calls these dark satanic mills. After 200 years, we realize what this, our progress, material progress, has done look at the condition of the earth,
yes.
The depletion of clear air, and then
natural resources.
That's it.
Yes.
So,
all and it all begins with the Industrial Revolution. Began
with that. Yes. Began with that.
And he saw it.
Because nobody at the time, nobody could think that all these factories belching out smoke, they would have any effect on the Earth atmosphere.
Yes. And others, of course, the war poets have written a lot about the cities.
That's it.
Destruction.
Mm.
I don't read them too much. Sassoon, I read a bit.
Sassoon, I was reading a few poems from him. But I find that they're very much, you know, very much on the surface. You read them once, you get everything. But, you know, poets like Blake or poets like Shelley, you know, you have to read them again and again and again, and only then the, you know, their greatness sort of comes to you, you realize.
Let's take a couple of minutes break,
sure.
And then we'll begin again.
Right.
Here we are again with Babu and part two of our conversations on poetry. Yes.
So again, John Masefield.
Mm-hmm.
This poem is not that well known, this poem of his. It's a short poem, but very, very beautiful. Up on the downs, the red-eyed kestrels hover, eyeing the grass. The field mouse flits like a shadow into cover as their shadows pass. Men are burning the gorse on the down shoulder. A drift of smoke glitters with fire and hangs, and the skies molder and the lungs choke. Once the tribe did thus on the downs, on these downs burning men in the frame, crying to the gods of the downs till their brains were turning, and the gods came. And today on the downs, in the wind, the hawks, the grasses, in blood and air, something passes me and cries as it passes on the chalk downland bare. I feel that, you know, as though he has, in spirit, he has gone back to the olden days, and he has actually seen the connection between man and God, and that men could aspire to God and call on God and God would come down.
Yes.
And he himself, in at present, he also feels the same thing. He feels a kind of presence in the on the downs. But there's another very tiny poem of his. It's called Beauty. It is another favorite poem of mine. I have seen dawn and sunset on moors and windy hills, coming in solemn beauty like the slow old tunes of Spain. I have seen the Lady April bringing the daffodils, bringing the springing grass and the soft, warm April rain. I have heard the song of the blossoms and the old chant of the sea, and seen strange lands from under the arched white sails of ships. But the loveliest things of beauty God ever has showed to me are her voice and her hair and eyes and the dear red curve of her lips. It's a very romantic poem and also very sensuous, but at the same time very delicately beautiful.
Yes, yes, I've read it before and I like it very much. Yes. We're moving ahead in time. Have you found any poets after this period coming into the 20th century that you feel have caught something?
Well, as I tell you that I'm really romantic at heart. And I don't find, you know, much. I appreciate some of these poets like T.S. Eliot, but and in some of his poems, but that is about all. I don't really think very highly of them.
I have a poem by Richard Wilbur. Have you heard of Richard Wilbur?
No.
I'd like to read that to you. Because it's very interesting about the poet's life. Praise in summer. Obscurely, yet most surely called to praise, as sometimes summer calls us all, I said, the hills are heavens full of branching ways where star-nosed moles fly overhead the dead. I said, the trees are mines in air. I said, see how the sparrow burrows in the sky. And then I wondered why this mad instead perverts our praise to uncreation. Why such savors in this wrenching things awry? Does sense so stale that it must needs derange the world to know it? To a praiseful eye, should it not be enough of fresh and strange that trees grow green and moulds can course in clay and sparrows sweep the ceiling of our day?
Wonderful. Really wonderful.
Wow.
No doubt about it.
This is a modern poet. But he rhymes also.
True.
He's got the rhythm.
He's got
the sound.
Very good rhythm.
So I'm seeking those whom Sri Aurobindo has spoken of and trying to research them. Of course, you and I have previously talked about A.E. And he's got to be one of my, maybe the most favorite of all.
I've got some poems of A.E. and Yeats.
Oh, wonderful.
This is my, from the olden days. See this one, for example, A, the vesture of the soul.
Oh, yes, I know it.
You remember that?
Please, that's wonderful. Oh.
I pitied one whose tattered dress was patched and stained with dust and rain. He smiled on me. I could not guess the viewless spirit's wide domain. He said, the royal robe I wear trails all along the fields of light. Its silent blue and silver bears for gems the starry dust of night. The breath of joy unceasingly waves to and fro its folds star-lit, and far beyond earth's misery I live and breathe the joy of it. It's a beautiful poem.
Do you have another?
I never get tired. Tired of E. Last time I think recited the dust. So
yes, you did.
That I did. Yes. So and did that. Shall I read out Krishna?
Sure. Wonderful.
Like it?
Yes.
I paused beside the cabin door and saw the King of Kings at play. Tumbled upon the grass, I spied the little heavenly runaway. The mother laughed upon the child, made gay by its ecstatic mourn. And yet the sage spake of it as of the ancient and unborn. I heard the passion breathe amid the honeysuckle-scented glade, and saw the king pass lightly from the beauty that he had betrayed. I saw him pass from love to love, and yet the pure allowed his claim to be the purest of the pure, thrice holy, stainless, without blame. I saw the open tavern door flash on the dusk a ruddy glare, and saw the king of kings outcast reel brawling through the starlit air. And yet he is the prince of peace, of whom the ancient wisdom tells, and by their silence men adore the lovely silence where he dwells. I saw the king of kings again, a thing to shudder at and fear, a form so darkened and so marred that childhood fled if it drew near. And yet he is the light of lights whose blossoming is paradise, that beauty of the king which dawns upon the seer's enraptured eyes. I saw the king of kings again, a miser with a heart grown cold, and yet he is the prodigal, the spendthrift of the heavenly gold, the largesse of whose glory crowns the blazing brows of cherubim, and sun and moon and stars and flowers are jewels scattered forth by him. I saw the king of kings descend the narrow doorway to the dust, with all his fires of morning still, the beauty, bravery and lust. And yet he is the life within the ever-living, living ones, the ancient with eternal youth, the cradle of the infant sons, the fiery fountain of the stars, and he the golden urn where all the glittering spray of planets in their myriad beauty fall. This is a beautiful thing, really.
Especially those last two lines.
They're really wonderful. And is that he's the urn, and everything comes out of that, and then when creation is over, they go back to that.
So you had mentioned to me two things that you found somewhat erroneous. One was the cabin.
One was the cabin.
And one was the drinking. The drinking. The tavern,
So, you see, I saw the open tavern door flash on the dusk a ruddy glare. Now, this open tavern door, it is absolutely unknown, especially of those days and in Krishna's time. They used to have drinking bouts, but we don't have any mention that they would go to any pub and drink. That really does not go. And also saw the king of kings outcast, reel brawling through the starlit air. You get a feeling of the bouncer throwing him out.
Yes.
So that I really, but you know, he has made up for it by giving the contrast.
Yes.
And yet he is the prince of peace, of whom the ancient wisdom tells, and by their silence men adore the lovely silence where he dwells.
And so you can't help
that. Everything makes up for everything, all the mistakes.
You said you had something of Yeats.
There's another one also. That also I don't agree. I saw the king of kings again, a miser with a heart grown cold.
Yeah.
We never see him.
Spendthrift of the heavenly
That's
gold.
That's it. But he is actually the spendthrift of the heavenly gold.
That's what he is.
So that is the main thing that makes up.
He comes to that. See, each time he brings out the higher.
That's it. Higher and the contrast.
Yes.
So I suppose he has done it for contrast.
Yes.
But the whole thing, it comes as a kind of shock, you know, that king of kings, a miser with a heart grown cold.
And tell us a little bit about how one should read Hexameter. Just now, Alok and I are doing a series on Ahana.
Oh, I see. Yes. Good.
So,
this is, you know, that this is really Sarvendra and Sarvendra's genius. Who are we to talk about it? But still, you know, with our little mind, we can at least make an attempt. That he was constantly thinking, we find it in the future poetry, that a new type of meter is a must. But he doesn't fully agree, or doesn't really agree, with the modern free verse. Free verse, that is, mm-hmm. where there is no rhyme, and the rhythm is very, very casual. Because he points out, even in Whitman, whom he praises so much,
yes.
that even he has lots and lots of defects, that is, in his versification, and sometimes it sounds very prosaic. So, but then he has a lot of respect and appreciation for Whitman, mainly from his, mainly because of his ideas, which are very modern, ultra-modern ideas, the idea of the human unity, idea of the oneness of the world, idea of coming to India and rediscovering the wisdom which will help mankind in the future to realize all these goals. So all these ideas are naturally they're very original and very earth-shaking in Whitman's time.
Yes.
At that time, how little was known about India. People used to think there's a country infested by snakes and all that, and all superstition, and that was all people yeah. knew about India.
Yeah.
But then at that time, Blake had the vision that India has lots to give to the world, and Sarvendra appreciates him. Then Sarvendra started thinking on what line the rhythm of the future poetry will come. As far as the substance and the subject matter, Sarvendra is quite convinced that people will now move more and more towards the spirit, and they would write more and more mystic poetry and spiritual poetry. And that's why he says that the mantra would be brought back. So for that, we have naturally Savitri, and there we find the mantic quality. Although Sarvendra himself wouldn't claim anything, he's much too humble, and he never talked about himself as a poet of the future. But then he was experimenting, and that experiment takes us to the quantitative meter.
Right.
Now, quantitative meter, he says that most of the ancient languages, they depended on this quantity. And we find in Sanskrit that they have laghu and guru. Laghu means light and very light vowels, and guru, the heavy vowels. So most of the lines are made out of this laghu and guru. In English, it is not possible, because English is a language where you put the stress on a particular syllable in a word. And that is not always, it doesn't sort of always follow the lightness of the vowel or the heaviness of the vowel. Say, for example, if you take the word it. Now, in some cases, although it is such a light vowel, but sometimes it can take a stress there. And for scanning, it can be taken as a stressed syllable, because it is stressed, it stands by itself. So he saw that many people in English poetry, the great prosodists, they had experimented with quantitative meter. And quantitative meter, the very word tells you, it depends on the quantity. quantity, that is, how many stress syllables should be there per line. Now, he found that they were not very successful. So he himself tried, and he thought in terms of the sonority of the French Alexandrine, and added to that, if it could be used in English, in the dactylic form. Not that there should be 12 syllables per line, but more, many more. So he has tried, he actually did it as a kind of experimentation. He started writing Ilian. But then we find that he has continued, and unfortunately he couldn't finish it, but he has written over 5,000 lines in Ilian. So, but then when he decided to write Savitri, he concentrated on that, and he went back to the standard iambic pentameter of the English language, which comes most naturally in English. But let's see this Book of Herald. It is in dactylic hexameter. That is long, short, short. It goes on like that. Dawn in a journey eternal, compelling the labor of mortals. Dawn, the beginner of things, and the night for their rest or their ending. Pallid and bright-lipped, arrived from the mists and the chill of the Euxine. Earth in the dawn fire, delivered from starry and shadowy vastness, woke to the wonder of life and its passion and sorrow and beauty, all on her bosom sustaining the patient, compassionate mother. That's how it begins. So it has got that rhythm. And if you scan it, you find that it follows the dactylic hexameter. Like dawn in the journey eternal, compelling. It goes on in that way. So
then what about quantitative hexameter?
Quantitative hexameter,
most think it's been a failure.
That's what Sirindu says, that I suppose because of the reason that English is not really a language for this quantitative meter. Because it has got its a type of rhythm which is natural to it. Mm-hmm. Now, if you try to impose something on it, then it doesn't sound true.
So, Ahana?
Yeah. Ahana is also in dactylic. I think it's in dactylic hexameter. You tell me?
You're the teacher. You are the teacher.
No. This is also in dactylic hexameter.
Mm-hmm.
This is also dactylic hexameter. But those lines of Ahana, they're really most beautiful.
Oh, yes.
The last few lines of Ahana, they're really superb. I read only that part, because there, you know, it comes out beautifully. Come then to Vrindavan, soul of the joyous, faster and faster, follow the dance I shall teach thee, with Shyama for slave and for master. Follow the notes of the flute, with a soul aware and exulting, trample delight that submits and crouch to a sweetness insulting. Thou shalt know what the dance meant, fathom the song and the singer. Here behind thunder, its rhythms touched by lightning thrill to its finger. Vrindavan's rustle shall understand, and Yamuna's laughter take thy place in the ras and thy share of the ecstasy after. So that's how Vahana ends. And these lines are, I find them most beautiful. This one thing that I find similar in Ilian and Ahana, naturally Ahana itself, as well as Savitri, is that Swamda always starts by describing the dawn. In Ilian also we found that he describes the dawn, but it is a very short one. In Savitri, naturally, is the symbol dawn. So there he goes all out, but some of these lines are truly fantastic there.
Well, let's take a break for a couple of minutes, and then I want to get into sharing with you some modern poets.